Not one, not two, nope! 11 launches, now on KNews! Hey guys, Lucas here, welcome to KNews for weeks 10 to 14, 2018, and as always a big shout out to you my KNews boosters on Patreon, who support this little show financially. Thanks for your trust and I hope you all had a great Easter weekend. I'm still way behind the rocket news, guys, and since I really want to go back covering launches before they actually happen, I decided to do an all-in-one episode for most missing launches up until last week. These are 11 in number, so I better not waste any more of your time. Let's go! Number 1 was a Falcon 9 which launched on March 6th from Cape Canaveral. Its destination was the usual geosynchronous transfer orbit where many communication satellites are shut into. Up top was Hispasat 30W6, where 30W stands for its orbital slot at 30 degrees west, counting from zero at the longitude of London, which was of course defined by the location of the Queen's loo. Just kidding, guys. This definition is a little older than the Queen and actually starts at the Greenwich Observatory, which interestingly has a statue of the first human in space, Yuri Gagarin. Although Falcon flew with its landing legs and grid fins attached, the booster was disposed at sea like a normal expendable rocket. SpaceX has a variety of reasons to do that, but I would say the main one is the upcoming Falcon 9 Block 5 version. Block 5 will be the final and truly reusable booster to fly multiple times, meaning SpaceX has to get rid of the older ones, which are pretty much obsolete at this point. I'm not sure how many Block 5s they will build, but they will stock them up and then switch production to the entirely new BF ship, which shall begin with its first hops in 2019. Pretty exciting, and I hope we will get to see it as it's being built and tested on the ground. Elon Musk actually showed the first tool for it just recently. It's a big rotating metal tube, which they will use to wrap carbon fibers around to create the main body of the ship. This is actually pretty similar to how regular plane bodies are made, so I guess they don't have to reinvent the wheel. Number 2 was a Soyuz, which launched on March 9th from Kourou for Ariane Space. Its destination was a rather unusual equatorial medium Earth orbit at an altitude of 8,000 kilometers. Up top were four communication satellites for O3b networks, simply called O3b, with a mass of 700 kilograms each. What boggles my mind a little are its 12 steerable dish antennas. Using these, each of them can track and cover a spot on the ground with its services. The diameter of each beam is roughly 700 kilometers wide, so a few of these are enough to cover whole countries. A cool fun fact, based on the orbital height, the satellites orbit Earth exactly 5 times a day, but because Earth does a full rotation below, they only manage to fly by each location 4 times in 24 hours. That's quite important to know if you plan to track them, I guess. The next launch was a Chinese Long March 2D that launched on March 17th from Jiuquan. Its destination was a sun-synchronous polar orbit with an altitude of 500 kilometers. Here only a quick mention of it because I have actually covered pretty much the same launch in a previous episode already. Up top back then was LKW3, where it is now its younger brother LKW4. Both belong to the same Earth observation constellation for the Chinese military and they are therefore treated rather secretive when it comes to the details of the payload. In other words, I can't tell you much about it. Launch number 4 was a crewed flight of Soyuz on March 21st from Baikonur in Kazakhstan. As all crewed launches this time around, it went to the ISS following its 51.6 degrees inclined orbit. The Soyuz MS-08 spacecraft was of course filled with all sorts of cargo like food, fresh air and other things, but most importantly the astro or cosmonauts. There was the Russian commander Oleg Artemyev, who is 47 years old and serves on the ISS for the second time. The two astronauts from the US are Andrew Feustel, who is 52 and on his third flight to space, and Richard Arnold, who is 54 and in space for the second time. Both are on the finished ISS for the first time, but helped to build it up using the space shuttle. Feustel was lucky to be one of those few who serviced the Hubble Space Telescope on a 40-day mission. STS-125 was the last mission, adding two more advanced imaging sensors to it. The Wide Field Camera 3 is the one which created some of those most iconic Hubble images in recent years, like this one, captured in infrared showing the Horsehead Nebula in the Orion star constellation. Yeah, this is what astronomers called a wild field of view. That wouldn't even be a single pixel on your smartphone if you take a picture of this guy. Launches number 5, 6 and 7 happened on March 29th and first was a GSLV Mk2 for India, which went to a geosynchronous transfer orbit. A few hours later and a few degrees more north was a Russian Soyuz that launched off Plesetsk to a sun-synchronous polar orbit. And lastly, another launch for China with a Long March 3B launching into a medium Earth orbit of round about 22,000 kilometers. On top GSLV was GSAT-6A, to which the Indian Space Agency sadly lost contact after its second orbit raising maneuver. The rocket performed nominally, so the error is with the satellite and there is no further information on that as I speak. The boosterless version of Soyuz, on the other hand, carried a small undisclosed spy satellite for Russia, while China's Long March 3B carried another pair of Baidu navigation system satellites to space. All these rockets launched, as mentioned, on the same day, which will probably happen more and more often in the future as China and the US step up their launch rate. Launch number Hachi was the second Falcon 9 in March on the 30th from Vandenberg, and its destination was a circular polar orbit. This launch should be really familiar by now because it is the fifth set of 10 Iridium Next satellites. The new constellation will be made up of 6 orbital planes with 11 operational satellites each and some on orbit spares. The name Iridium, by the way, originates from the element Iridium with the atomic number 77, which refers to the number of satellites. Pretty clever actually, but the next constellation will only feature 75 satellites, at least according to SpaceX handout, so a more fitting name would maybe be Rhenium. But enough nitpicking, renaming a company because the number of satellites changes would be silly. And next on my list is the last Chinese one for today, which was a Long March 4C. It took off from Taiwan on March 31st into a sun-synchronous polar orbit. I first wanted to skip quickly through this one because it's another Earth-observing satellite, but I actually found an interesting paper showcasing some of the techniques used to create 3D ground images by this Gaofen 1, and I'm sure others use these too. Thinking about 3D images, it's apparent that it takes two 2D images from different perspectives to create one. We ourselves do that too with our two eyes, a few centimeters apart. The 3D image generation is then done in our brain, which basically creates a three-dimensional world of our surroundings. We can close our eyes and move around without running into solid objects. Quite a powerful tool, although my pinky toe is not impressed by that. The difficulty to achieve that watching from orbit is higher due to the relatively small ground features. Instead of using a 3D camera as you do on ground, satellites combine multiple images from different positions in their orbit into one. How this basically looks like is the satellite not only takes images from what is directly below, but what is in front, in the back, and to the sides. Going round and round the globe, it collects data from at least 5 different angles of every location. Knowing the angles at which these images were shot allows the software to generate a 3D world. I find that really cool, but a system like this also has its drawbacks. Cars, for example, that move around can't be tracked and therefore don't appear off any of the final images. In case you ever wondered why Google Maps, for example, shows 3D buildings and parked cars, but the roads are almost empty. I'm sure they use a similar technique on their planes, which could be fixed in the future with a swarm of drones that scan in 3D simultaneously. Number 10 is another Falcon 9 launch, this time from Cape Canaveral on April 2nd. Its destination was the ISS and therefore, like Soyuz before, a 51.6 degrees inclined orbit. Up top was a Dragon version 1 spacecraft with cargo like food supplies, fresh air and new experiments. For those who wonder why they are still using Dragon 1 and not their newer version 2, it's because Dragon 2 has to go through all kinds of NASA qualifications to get human rated. It's a very time consuming process, but we will see it fly for the first time later this year and with a little bit of luck maybe even carrying astronauts. However, that schedule is likely to get pushed further back into 2019, but I stay optimistic. And the last launch I want to cover in this episode is an Ariane 5 that flew for the first time after its incident in January this year. It took off from Kourou as usual and went into the correct geosynchronous transfer orbit. The reason for the issue was meanwhile resolved and found to be a programming error. Someone basically put the wrong value into its onboard computer, so the rocket aligned its orientation based on a slightly rotated coordinate system. It turned 20 degrees off course, but still achieved a stable orbit and the satellites will be able to correct it, burning extra fuel. Anyways, now up top Ariane 5 were two communication satellites, Superbird B3 for Japan and HYLAS 4 for the United Kingdom. Superbird will be placed at 162 degrees east near Japan, while HYLAS will move into its slot at 33.5 degrees west to cover this region with broadcasting services for Avanti Communications. Okay, That shall be enough for this episode, and I hope to see you in the next one with more recent launches if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.